From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
My name is Rob Casper. I'm the head of the Poetry and Literature Center here at the Library of Congress. And I'm very excited to welcome you all to our first event featuring the National Book Foundation's 5 Under 35 honorees. Before we begin, I'd like to ask you to turn off your cell phones, as I just did, and all other electronic devices that you have that might interfere with the recording of this event. I also want to let you know that this event is being recorded for webcast, and if you choose to participate in the Q&A session at the end, you will give us permission to use your question for those webcasts. Also, let me tell you a little bit about the Poetry and Literature Center. We are the home to the U.S. Poet Laureate. Juan Felipe Herrera is our current Poet Laureate. We also put on literary readings, lectures, and panels of all sorts throughout the year. If you would like to find out more about events like this here at the library, we have a sheet you can sign up in the foyer. We also have information on the Poetry and Literature Center if you're interested in finding out about the center itself. Finally, you can look us up at www.loc.gov/poetry. You'll notice on your seat, hopefully, a survey. We're trying to figure out how we can better serve our constituency and provide quality programming. So if you can take a second before the end of this event and fill it out and give it to me or to Anya Crichton, who's right there, she's raising her hand, that would be terrific. So we're really excited to partner with the National Book Foundation to celebrate their 535 program, which I've been a fan of since the inception. I actually had the opportunity to go to the very first 535 reading, and it was a madhouse, and everyone was abuzz with the possibilities of the program, and it's been wonderful to see it reach that potential and reach it and exceed it. Let me tell you a little bit about the panel today. Each 535 honoree will read a brief selection of their work, and National Book Foundation Program Manager Benjamin Samuel will lead a moderated discussion afterwards. And as I said, we'll have time for a Q&A to end things up. Then we'll have a break, and then our 535 honorees will come back here to this very same room for a reading at 6:30 tonight, followed by a book signing. So we hope you come back and celebrate them some more, get a chance to really hear them read their work. And now I'd like to turn things over to Benjamin Samuel. In addition to his role in the National Book Foundation, Samuel is editor-at-large at Electric Lit and co-founder of its weekly fiction magazine, Recommended Reading. He is also a recent joinee of the Brooklyn Literary Council, a great organization that I was once a part of back when I lived in New York. Please join me in welcoming Benjamin Samuel.
Hello. Thank you, Rob. And thank you all so much for having us here. It's truly an honor to be here at the Library of Congress and sharing the talents of our 2015 5 Under 35 honorees with you. Their books are remarkable and wonderfully diverse works of fiction, and it's clear to me and to the Foundation and to our audience that these writers will continue to influence the literary landscape for many years to come. Just a quick thing about the Foundation and the 5 Under 35 program. So the National Book Foundation's 5 Under 35 honorees are writers under the age of 35 who have each published one book of fiction, either a short story or short story collection or a novel, within the last 5 years. Honorees are selected by National Book Award winners, finalists, and as of this year, which is the 10th anniversary of the program, other 5 Under 35 honorees. Since 2006, the 5 Under 35 program, which is sponsored by the Amazon Literary Partnership, has consistently recognized young debut writers poised to make a lasting impression on the literary landscape. Previous honorees include Danielle Evans, Nam Lee, Valeria Luiselli, Karen Russell, Kirsten Valdez-Quade, Justin Torres, Claire V. Watkins, and Tiffany Yannick, as well as National Book Award finalist Taya Obrett and 2014 National Book Award winner for fiction Phil Klei. So before this panel begins, as Rob mentioned, I'm going to briefly introduce each honoree, and then the honoree will come up, describe their work in their own words, and then read a page from their book. Our first reader tonight is Colin Barrett. Colin Barrett was born in 1982 and grew up in County Mayo, Ireland. In 2009, he was awarded the Penguin Ireland Prize. His stories have appeared in Stinging Fly magazine, A Public Space, Five Dials, and The New Yorker. Young Skins is his first book. Please welcome Colin Barrett.
How you doing, everyone? And I am from Ireland. Thanks for coming out, because it is filthy out there. It's like Ireland, that weather. So I'm just going to read a really quick couple of paragraphs from one of the stories in the collection, Young Skins. It's a collection of stories that are linked by being set, by virtue of being set in the same fictional West of Ireland town, on the west coast of Ireland. And this is just the opening of a story called Diamonds. I left the city with my connections scorched and my prospects blown, looking only for somewhere to batten down for the winter to come. I left on a bright morning in August, dozing fitfully as the train drifted through the purgatorial horizontals of the Midlands heading west. The Midland skies were huge, drenched in pearlescent light and stacked with enormous chrome confections of cloud. Their wrinkled undersides greyly streaked and mottled, brimming with whatever rain is before it becomes rain. Each time I came to and checked the carriage window, the same cow seemed to be eyeing me from the same sodden tobacco-brown field, or each cow bore the same expression, the huge jaws mechanically working a wad of cud back and forth, the dark eyes registering me with the same steady and sullen incuriosity. Thank you.
Thanks, Colin. Our next reader is Angela Flournoy, who is a graduate from the Iowa Writers' Workshop, where she received a Dean's Fellowship, and the University of Southern California. She's taught writing at the University of Iowa and Trinity Washington University, and has worked for the Washington, D.C. Public Library. She was raised in Southern California by a mother from Los Angeles and a father from Detroit. The Turner House, her first novel, was a finalist for the 2015 National Book Award for Fiction.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming this afternoon. I lived in DC for 2 years, and so I know it's very much a 9-to-5 town. I never had a 9-to-5 when I was here, so it's very good to see people during those hours here for literature. So my novel, The Turner House, is set in 2008 Detroit, but it's sort of an intergenerational novel. It follows the story of one family, their migration from the South to Detroit, and it sort of centers around their relationship with this house on the east side of the city, which is a very depopulated part of the city. The Turners are sort of a big clan. There's 13 adult siblings. The eldest is 64, the youngest is 41. So the section that I'm going to read is from fairly early on in the book, and it concerns Layla, the 13th Turner child. The chips looked like candy, pastel melt-away things that didn't make sense to save. The feel of them, the click and dry slide of them in her palm was gratifying. Some people in Gamblers Anonymous, a place she hadn't been in months, claimed the tiny ball. Spinning and spinning around on its wheel was the reason they loved the game. It's like you get a bonus, a little bit of show from that ball. Zach, a white man who always wore a suit and tie, once said. Other people in the group had nodded knowingly. Layla stood at the foot of the roulette table, just having a look, she told herself. If she were playing, she would never stand here, so far away from the wheel and the top half of the board, a position where she'd end up asking strangers to put her chips where she wanted them to go. If she were playing, she'd request the orange chips, depending on the dealer. But she couldn't play right now. She'd spent the last of her cash on lunch for herself and her grandson, and she didn't know whether she'd be approved for unemployment, so she couldn't spend the last 183 in the bank. No more bets, the dealer said. He waved a pudgy, upturned palm over the table. People settled back into their chairs. The ball landed on 00. There were a few cheers, but mostly groans. It was a crowded night in Motor City Casino. Thank you.
Next up is Megan Cruz. Megan Cruz grew up in the rural Pacific Northwest. She studied creative writing at Oberlin College and earned her MFA at the University of Montana, writing about lonely places and our faulty, beautiful hearts. It's the most poetic bio, I think. her work has appeared widely in journals and anthologies, and she recently completed residencies at the Kimmel Harding Nelson Center for the Arts in Nebraska and the New York Mills Regional Cultural Center in Minnesota. Her debut novel, Call Me Home, was released from Hawthorne Books in 2015. She is the 2015 to 2016 visiting writer in residence at Eastern Oregon's University, low residency MFA program. She lives in Seattle. Megan Cruz.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Ben. And thanks for having us. This has been such a joy. Although I don't know how you tell the buildings apart because I visited the other presidents as well. my book, Call Me Home, it's told in three voices, a mother and her two children, Jackson and Lydia, who live in Tulalip, Washington, which is a town I grew up in, conveniently. So this is told from, I'm just going to read a bit, told from Lydia's perspective when she's about nine. At night, I lay awake and listen to my parents talking. Not the words, just the sounds. I love you, I hate you, I'm sorry. Jackson was in his room all the time listening to music on his headphones and drawing in his notebook. Now that he was 14, he kept his door shut all the time and wouldn't let me hear his music, but still he let me come in and sit by him. I stared into the snowy tunnels of the blankets. On weekends, he'd take me with him to Randy's house, and while he and Randy smoked pot, I would hold a lizard, let it crawl up my arms and around my shoulders. In August, the pig escaped again, and my father called the butcher. I was sad but didn't say it. I stared at the square white packages lined up like coffins in the freezer. I held one in my hand until it burned from cold. I tried not to look at the empty place in the pasture where the pig had been. When my father broke my mother's nose, I made his sandwich out of the bacon I would never eat myself. My hands were shaking to touch that bacon. I carried the sandwich to my bedroom and brought the rag out of the dark space behind my bed. I poured the glass dust into my hand and looked at it shining, and then I laid it between the mayonnaise and the meat. It was the perfect sandwich. It was the worst thing I'd ever done. I stood in my bedroom and looked at the sandwich. I tried to pick up the plate, to carry it to my father. I counted to 10, and then I counted it to 10 again. The plate was heavy as the moon. I couldn't move. Now, I thought, do it now. When I heard my father's boots in the hall, I couldn't breathe. He was coming toward me, and all I had to do was hold it up. It was a gift for him to take, but I ruined it all. I ran past him with the plate in my hands, out the back door and into the woods behind the house, where I buried the sandwich in the dirt by the creek. I threw the plate into the underbrush, and no one ever knew. Now I think that if I had told Jackson, it would have been different. He would have helped me to be brave. He would have understood how badly I wanted my father to disappear, and what happened later might not have happened at all. But I thought Jackson already knew. He was the one beside me in the grass outside, trying to keep me from hearing them. The pig was nowhere, but still he held me there in the grass, scratching the dirt, saying low, low, listen, you can hear the hooves, listen. Thanks.
you, Megan. Next is Tracy O'Neill, who is a writer living in Brooklyn. In 2012, she was awarded the New York City Emerging Writers Fellowship by the Center for Fiction. Her novel, The Hopeful, was published in June 2015, and her short fiction has appeared or is forthcoming in Guernica, Granta, The Literarian, Volume 1 Brooklyn, and Promethean. You can read her nonfiction in The Atlantic, Grantland, Book Forum, Rolling Stone, and TheNewYorker.com. She currently teaches at FIT and the City College of New York. Tracy O'Neill.
Hi, thank you guys so much for being here today. I'm going to just read a page. The only information that you need to know going into this chapter is that Mo, who was mentioned, is the narrator's cousin. At AA, most of the conversation was identification. You know you've got a problem when you've never left the last sip. You know you've got a problem when the hair of the dog gets so big, it's another dog. These people were Darwinian wonders. Around the circle, the stories and voices were different, but the revelations were the same. I've got a problem. Who knew you could do this to yourself and stay alive? Some people held a pastry in one hand and coffee in the other. I watched Mo eat three pastries, the sheen of spit and sugar glinting stickily around his mouth. You know you've got a problem, one woman began, when you say, beer's not alcohol, it's a carbonated beverage. A few people laughed and nodded. I met this girl once outside a bar I'd been kicked out of. She told me I should grab a matchbook from every bar I was asked to leave. You know, get my money's worth. I told her, honey, my apartment's not big enough for that. I couldn't tell if her pride was that of successful joking or of the audacity of radical drinking. Another woman said it wasn't that she chose quantity over quality. It was that she'd always thought quantity was quality. Two fingers? More like 2 feet, she said, miming a glass of scotch the size of her torso. I'm down 2 teeth, a man told the circle. 32 is how many permanent teeth a human being is supposed to have, and I've had 30 since I lost 2 to a shot glass. After the implants, my sister said to me, an Irish car bomb tastes just like a milkshake, so why didn't I just drink a milkshake? How do you explain to someone like that, my taste isn't for taste? He balled up a napkin. I keep wondering when I'm going to feel like an after photo in a diet commercial, you know, smiling, proud, just holding up my old pants and seeing evidence that I'm better off. Thinking about not thinking about it is still just thinking about it, though. So I ask myself all the time, am I really getting any better, or am I just taking the scenic route?
Thanks, Tracy. Our next reader is Azarine Vandervliet Olumi. Azarine is the author of Fra Keeler. She is the recipient of a 2015 Whiting Writers Award, a McDowell Fellowship, and a Fulbright Fellowship to Catalonia, Spain. She's lived in Italy, Spain, Iran, and the United Arab Emirates, and in the USA. She currently teaches in the MFA program in creative writing at the University of Notre Dame and splits her time between South Bend, Indiana, and Florence, Italy. Azarine.
Hi, everybody. Thanks so much for being here. And thanks again to the National Book Foundation and to the Library of Congress for hosting us. I'm just going to read the first page from the novel Fra Keeler. And the only thing you really need to know is that the narrator has purchased the home of Fra Keeler and has begun to investigate the circumstances of his death. And reality becomes progressively more uncertain as the novel progresses. It's on the edge of a canyon, the realtor said, raising his eyebrows when I offered to buy the home without having looked at it first. Fine, I said, though I wasn't sure exactly what the realtor meant. Then I didn't say anything for a long time because I was thinking of Fra Keeler's death. And it seemed the realtor wanted to repeat what he had just said, his eyebrows even more tense. Some things aren't worth looking into, I said, and the realtor's eyebrows slackened a bit. Then I asked, where are the papers? Here they are, he said. I'd like to sign them, I said, and he pushed them across the table with his middle finger. What an ugly finger, I remember thinking while I signed the papers, and then I got up and I left. We are said to die of one thing on paper, but it is entirely of something different that we die, I thought as I left the realtor's office. And it is dangerous to take the discrepancy between the two for granted, what one actually dies of, and what one is said to have died of on paper. There is hardly ever a correspondence. And I'm thinking now that some people's deaths need to be thoroughly investigated. I'm more than certain that I thought this then, too, as I left the realtor's office, but the thought wasn't as highly illuminated in my head. I'm thinking now, it isn't every day one comes across a death that is especially timely and magnificent, for example, Frau Keeler's death. And then one really has to wonder, one has to begin to think, to retrace the mental footsteps of the deceased person, Frau Keeler, since the chance that such a timely death would remain unexplained on paper is that much more significant. Thank you.
Thanks, Azarine. Actually, could we get just one more applause for our readers? So this is a question for all of you. 535 is a prize that recognizes young writers at the beginnings of their careers. So I think it makes sense to start our discussion there. When did you first realize you wanted to be a writer? You could start.
I could start. Yeah, whoever. I don't think I ever really realized I wanted to be a writer. It just sort of was a necessary thing that I started doing. When I was 19, I think I started, and very quickly it just sort of became part of my life, and I couldn't sort of spend too many days without writing. And it wasn't until I actually went to an MFA program and finished this manuscript that I realized I was sort of embracing an identity as a writer, but it sort of just feels like a part of who I am.
Yeah, I would say that you need to realize it every day. It's one thing to realize you want to be a writer, but it's another thing to do that and then also have your labor adhere to that. So it's something that I think about every time I sit down.
Yeah, I would say that I've never really had any other dreams. I didn't let myself have any other dreams, really. And it's just sort of grueling kind of single-minded focus, which has had good and bad results in my larger life. But I think one of the things I'm realizing, too, is that every, I wrote two novels before this that will stay unpublished forever, thankfully. But with each one, I remember thinking, like, this is it. Like, here we go. Here comes, like, you know, my big break. And just this idea that there was this ship that would suddenly come into port and everybody would welcome you on board and say, like, you finally made it. Now you're a writer and you can relax, you know? And I think that what Tracy was saying about recognizing that every day, I think the realization that I continue to make is that there is no, you know, there are these temporary destinations. It's sort of like what Anne Lamott says about writing a novel, is that you have to have a temporary destination as you're writing it, and that changes. I think the same thing comes from writing over time, is that you create these temporary destinations for yourself, and when you get there, you realize you haven't quite arrived yet, you know, and one book becomes the next book, and, you know, it is, despite the, you know, what a great honor it is to be in this 535 group, it's writing, you know, we talk about it, it's one of the things you can consistently get better at until you are, you know, until you're very, very old. And I think that there's a great comfort to me in that, to think that you can continue to develop your craft for the rest of your life.
I got my first journal as a gift when I think I was like 7 or 8. And before that, I had already
for a few years before that, already been sort of a very enthusiastic reader, and it just seemed like the next logical thing is to try to kind of mimic what I had been reading, various levels of success, and that sort of just continued. One of the things, you know, Megan, you mentioned how the destinations keep sort of changing is, you know, the more that you read, the more your taste just changes or gets better, or you just read something that you're like, I didn't even know that was like allowed or possible. And then that is, you know, sort of what makes you want to keep going. But really my whole entire life, I've been writing.
I'd have something similar. I always sort of, when you're a kid, you kind of did it unconsciously, or maybe it blended with reading. Like I read kind of spottily. I didn't grow up in a house with a lot of books necessarily, but I would read comic books, and even just like watching cartoons was absorbing narrative, and it would just blur. You know, I'd read a comic book and then I'd try and draw a little version of it. So I was always interested. When I look back at it now, obviously I got kind of serious, or would be serious about it when you're a teenager, as a lot of people do. You start reading the perhaps more deeply and diversely. But up to then, I'd always, in retrospect, looking back, I'd always been interested in narrative. Even when I would like go and play in the yard with like other little boys, my friends from down the road, and they'd have like a toy truck, and I'd say, what are you playing? And the guy'd be like, well, I'm playing fire truck. And I was like, what's the arc? What's the story? Where's the fire truck going? Who's in it? And who's his antagonist, you know? What does fire truck want to stop or protect? So that's what I was always interested from being a kid.
Yeah, I think, too, just to piggyback on that, the idea of just storytelling, I think, you know, I love hearing people tell stories, and I think that that's probably a commonality, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it sounds like a lot of you sort of view being a writer as a process, and that it's ongoing. But the term writer itself, you know, sort of identifying as a writer, does that kind of bear any sort of, as you define it, does it have any sort of responsibilities, or does it provide any sort of liberties in your life, something that you have to like live up to or sort of avoid because you're a writer, you know?
I think it's such a good and tough question. For me, like I was saying before, it's just intrinsic to who I am. I don't think of it as separate from myself. And I think that can sort of have consequences in your larger life, the way people might perceive you, or the way that you sort of embody your writing, and the kinds of the lifestyle that you choose to lead. So I sort of organize my days around writing, and my whole life is sort of structured around it, to sort of find silence and moments of reading and just reflecting, to have that kind of space. And it is an ongoing process. It's not separate from the way that life is an ongoing process. So I'd say that's very much, it's very organic for me, but also requires a great deal of discipline at the same time. You have to carve that space out and be really committed to it and really protective of it, because the world will push back against you, and you have to continually manage expectations from the outside that don't necessarily support your practice as a writer.
Yeah, I think the other thing about writing is that you also, if you're writing responsibly, I don't think you always think writing is the most important thing, right? Like you approach life and the problems of other people or the struggles of other people with some openness, and also understand that writing is a privilege. Of course, we have to do things like protect our writing time and space, but also recognizing that not everybody gets to do this, so it's something to be grateful for, I think, as well. But also it depends on the genre. You know, if I'm working in nonfiction, which I also do, then the responsibilities in terms of the prose itself are very, very different. Sometimes at that point, it's not about the most beautiful sentence. Sometimes it's about getting as close as you can to accurately representing something, which might not be as graceful. So, yeah.
I would say that I, like I was saying about not ever having any other dreams, I think I'm really grateful for that in a lot of ways, because I think that I'm aware that there are so many people in the world who, you know, you're just born into this life and you think, like, what am I supposed to do with it? And I think that kind of being in a hazy interim spot of not knowing what you want to do could be pretty agonizing. But that said, I've only just now felt comfortable telling people that I'm a writer since this book came out, which has been, it's like this very liberating privilege I've allowed myself. But I think in terms of responsibilities, I guess I've always felt a responsibility to write towards the kind of world that I want to live in. And I think that that means representing characters who haven't always been represented on the page, or, you know, a lot of my work focuses on queer characters and rural places where those narratives haven't previously existed. And that has always been a pretty important drive to me, is to write the stories that weren't there when I was growing up, that I didn't have to read, and to bring those to the page.
I think if there's one thing that sort of being a capital W writer or a capital A author, sort of for me, the responsibility is to sometimes do things that are against my sort of inclination. I'm a person who is a sort of kind of like, wait and see, let's wait and see. Let's wait and weigh all of the options. But I also think that, like Tracy mentioned, you know, not everyone gets to do this, and there are certain like things that aligned, happenstance, luck, and, you know, yes, hard work, but a lot of other things were just privilege and happenstance and luck that sort of got me to the place where that I can do this. And so I do feel a responsibility to sort of bear witness. That doesn't mean that I necessarily always think I need to write in a realm of realism about what is happening exactly at the present moment in my community, but I do think that in some way I need to accurately reflect the communities that I am writing about. And I do feel like that's probably the thing I think about most. And also something that happens, I don't know if you guys have experienced this, when you write a book, people just start emailing you thinking that you have like answers for all sorts of things that may or may not have anything to do with what you wrote about in the book, right? And so a lot of times you just like, so editors for various magazines or websites, they might be like, do you want to write an essay about this? And sometimes, again, because I have this part of me that's like, wait and see, let's just, you know, examine all the possibilities, I just, you know, the inclination is to say, no, I don't want to do this. But sort of one of the things that I'm learning is that if you have this, any sort of, if you have this talent and you have the time and the privilege to be able to write, you sort of owe it to yourself and to others to sometimes actually like make a public declaration about how you feel about something. For instance, this summer was the 50th anniversary of the Watts Uprising / riots, depending on what you want to call it. And an editor at the LA Times asked me to write about it. And at first I was like, wait and see. Don't make a public declaration. And then the more I thought about it, the more I felt like, no, I have to actually say something. And I think that's important for me anyway.
Yeah, kind of picking up on what Angela said there. It's a constantly contradictory state being a writer, because you know you're writing things and eventually you want to put them into the public sphere. You know, hopefully to a sympathetic audience or anyone at all who pay attention, but. But I get what I'm just saying about the wait and see. It's my impulse too. Whenever I'm asked to do anything or talk about anything, it's not to evade it or anything, but it is a case of wanting to address it, I don't know, correctly or in the fullness of time and on your own terms, and not feel that there is that sort of need sometimes. And again, if you're lucky enough, that the LA Times is coming to ask your opinion or to write an op-ed piece about something. But there is that sort of compulsion for an immediate answer, an immediate diagnosis of a situation in the media. And, I think fiction is probably, you're trying to do something different. You're trying to address those things, but just not directly, not reflexively. And it's above all, probably you're trying to shape it to your own subjective experience, and that's what's going to resonate with people. So I kind of only bring it up because, I mean, I was writing these collection of short stories, and I was writing them for years, and they're set in a small town. It's a fictional version of where I'm from. But the book came out in 2013 in Ireland initially, and it was framed as a kind of post-recession novel because Ireland had had about 8 years of prosperity after several hundred centuries of non-prosperity, basically. And then things slammed on the brakes again, the economy in 2008. So the book was kind of in a lot of the reviews and whatnot. It was framed in that context as a response to that, for instance. And that was probably there. I was living that. But good God, I couldn't couldn't write like an op-ed directly about it, and I wouldn't want to. I wouldn't want to. You do want these things to sink into your skin and then sort of bubble away under there, and then they come up. They surprise you at a later point, and they come up obliquely. I forget what your question has been.
That addressed it. Good. So actually, something, Colin, that we learned about you on the at the ceremony on Monday is that you had a history of working with Vodafone. I was wondering, a lot of you I know are asked by editors to write certain pieces for their magazines, or you pitch your own, or you teach. But sustaining a writing life, it isn't just about finding the time. It's about making ends meet. Sure. So, I'm curious, and maybe you guys are curious as well, what your day jobs look like and whether you think that there is an ideal day job for a writer, or maybe it's just, having some sort of person there backing you and paying your rent. maybe some of you have that. You'd be very lucky.
A private sponsor.
Yeah, like the old days. Right? Do you want to take the lead?
I've worked a lot of different kinds of jobs, but at the moment I teach in the MFA program at the University of Notre Dame, and it's very demanding work, and it still sort of requires a great deal of waking up very early and sitting at your desk every day, no matter what, whether you're exhausted or you have 50 emails in your inbox or theses to read. But one of the great things about it is actually relates to the question of responsibility, is that I think for me, one of the beautiful things fiction can do is sort of you get to kind of ask, what does it mean to be human? What does it mean to have a mind? And how does experience or how do sort of events in the world alter your consciousness? And to be able to have that conversation with a great deal of rigor in the classroom with young students is really beautiful, to sort of come back to that every week and listen to them and have sort of conversations across generations, because they're younger than me, the undergraduates especially, and I have colleagues who are older, colleagues who are sort of retiring, and an international community there. So sort of that question is always in flux, and it's also part of process. So it links up pretty well with the writing practice, but of course also requires a great deal of concentration, because then you're always inhabiting literature. And you were saying sometimes it's good to sort of maybe use a different part of your brain for your day job. I think everybody's different. What serves one person doesn't necessarily serve another.
Yeah, so right now I am teaching one class only, and I'm also doing a PhD, and the PhD actually happens to be the way that I make most of my money. It's a funded program. And before that, I was adjuncting for 4 years, and I was teaching like 5 classes a semester and going between schools and shuttling around. And before that, I had about 1 million bartending jobs. And there was one point when I was in my MFA program, and I had like just made a payment to the school for fees or something, and I got fired from my job at this nightclub. And I remember coming home, and of course it's nightclub hours, so at this point it was probably 5:30 a.m. I was really, really tired, and I just kept thinking, okay, well, I just made this payment. I think I have like $200 right now. What am I going to do? And so, you know, I went home, and I was on Craigslist at 5:30 in the morning, like applying to jobs, and I think there was a period there for maybe like 9 months where I think I had like 11 jobs over the course of 9 months. But I knew that's what I needed to do to be able to write. And I guess that's partially what I mean by writing being a privilege, in the sense that you're, you know, having the time to write is a huge privilege, and having the time plus, you know, some place to live where you can be alone, you know, and not say sharing a room with 8 other people is, you know, as some people do. But I think I also think that doing that has been really important to me, in the sense that it's allowed me to understand that not everybody has my life. And sometimes the writing world can become extremely sort of closed, and it can start feeling a little bit like an echo chamber, I think. And so for me, these jobs have actually been really helpful in thinking more directly about things like class, or, you know, the sort of even issues of manners across cultures that might come up in a bar, or issues of racism that might come up at the door of a nightclub. You know, I've worked at places where they've debated, you know, do we let people in who, you know, maybe have a hijab, or, you know, are wearing a burqa or something? Like, could there be some sort of weapons in there? And of course, these are incredibly racist people, right? But, you know, sometimes when you're operating in the writing world, it seems like everybody you know is very nice and very liberal, and how could there possibly be these problems in the world? So, I mean, these jobs have been important to me, is what I'm saying.
I wrote most of this book while I was the only bartender at Andy's Lounge in Luling, Texas, where it's the home of the annual Watermelon Thump. I worked a lot of really crappy jobs, I guess. Now I am finally starting to reach a point where I'm starting to kind of be able to teach on the levels that I want to be able to teach on, but that was sort of post-novel. And before that, I think I had a lot of fear and about whether or not, you know, about making those decisions against security. And I still don't know. I could feel like it's working well for me now that I'm starting to teach on the university level, but I don't know. Was that that is a privilege, and was it a wise one? I don't know. I still don't have. I feel like I have very little security financially, and I like talking about those things because I think that the writing world tends to not talk about it, and that creates a sense of, you know, this sense, this idea that maybe there's writing attached to books, and there's very little writing attached to actual books themselves, in my experience. And
you mean money attached?
Oh, yeah, what did I say?
Writing.
Oh.
Yeah, I don't even write these. They just arrive. You know? It's like that idea of the muse that I'm kind of counter against, where somebody walks into a room and, like, the wind picks up, and then, like, the characters just come and bat them around, and then they come out later disheveled, like, having written something, you know? And it's just like, oh, like, you did the work, you know? But I just think, like, you know, I have made so little money on this book, and it's not, but it has opened a lot of doors for me. And I think that talking about the actual amount of money, just so that, you know, I don't begrudge writers who have other sources of money besides working day jobs. Like, that's fine. But I do think it does us a disservice when we pretend that that money comes organically from the, you know, the writing of the books. And I think it causes a lot of sense of, like, well, what am I doing wrong? And I just wish there was more dialogue around it, because I also think that's a way to start making people put more money into books, is not pretending that a small press book is going to generate enough money to live on even for more than a month, you know? So I think that being open about that is important to me, and it's something I like to talk about with my students. Not, you know, I'm not bitter about it, about the amount of money, because, like I said, this book has been crucial to me moving along in my career path, and I'm teaching in a low residency MFA program, which I love, but I just think we need dialogue about it. So.
The city was probably the site of most of my financial struggle while writing this book, which is funny in a way. I was, like, eager to leave, but now when I come back, I feel fondly, you know, when I think fondly. There used to be a restaurant on 4th and H called True Orleans. I don't know if any of you guys remember it. It was, like, a not good, like, Creole Cajun Louisiana restaurant. I worked there. they still owe me money. but it's now, like, a Mediterranean restaurant or something. And I worked at Montgomery College, and I worked at Trinity College, and then I finally got a job at DC Public Library. To answer your question, Ben, a library job might be my ideal job as a writer.
Interesting.
If it paid more. it was wonderful. It was the best. It was really humbling, because it was when I was turning in edits, I sold the book while I was at the restaurant. I actually sold it, like, in the walk-in freezer of the restaurant. Then I got the call from my agent that I, like, had to make a decision. But I did all my edits while I was at DCPL, and it was great. And it's also really humbling, because libraries have to weed. I don't know if this illustrious institution has to, but, you know, especially the branches in DC Public Library, they've got to weed books. And sometimes a book that is, like, a huge, like, MFA program star, we all love it, it's literary, it's out of there. Like, it's just not being checked out, and it's gone. Or, you know, you have, like, 4 copies. Like, it could be, like, it could win the Booker. And, you know, our branch has 4 copies, but over the course of 2 months, we've weeded it down to 1, because we've got to make, you know, room for the latest, you know, whatever, fill the blank other writer. And something about that just made me, it just was really useful and reminded me that nobody asked me to write this book, and sort of the situations that I put myself in financially to write the book were the situations that I put myself in financially to write the book. And so that's one thing that I try to remind myself, is that nobody asked me to write the book. So I look now, especially on the sort of not in that kind of, not as much in the financial crunch, I think about it fondly, because it was a choice and a 4-year sacrifice I made.
Well, yeah, as you alluded, Ben, I worked in Vodafone, which is a phone company, a mobile phone company. I don't know if Vodafone exists over here in that incarnation. I worked there for full time for like four or five years after I finished college. I did an English degree, basically an English literature degree, in UCD in Dublin. And I finished that in maybe 2003, and at that point there were no like MA or MFA programs in Ireland. You couldn't do them. There's a few in the UK. They've since become incredibly popular in every college, and third level institute in Ireland has one now, and a master's program, and you know, they're hugely, they're very popular with students. They're, you know, massively oversubscribed. It's helping produce a lot of young writers in Ireland in the last few years. As I said, even just when I came out of college, you couldn't. It wasn't really an option to go take that next step in terms of third level to go and do an MA and workshop with you know, like-minded people. So I wrote around the work, my 40-hour working week, you know, and maybe did bits in work instead of actually doing work. I did it full time, and then once the MA programs came in, I did do one in 2008 in UCD, and after that I worked part-time. When I was finishing this book, Young Skins, I was working in a different phone company, Aircom. evenings I did part-time, so I worked Monday to Friday from 5 to 9, cold calling people, mainly very old people, because Aircom was a sort of landline. It was a former government-controlled company, and then it got privatized, and it just wasn't run very well and didn't offer a very good service. So the only people that still had it were people who are very hostile and suspicious of things like the internet. So like very, very old farmers in like down in Leitrim or somewhere who were like, you know, you got your landline there. I can, you know, send you a mobile phone for 20, 30 bucks and we can stick the internet into your house there and you can start using that whenever you want. And they'd be like, no. there was one point where there was a certain part of the certain town somewhere, it was in Leitrim or somewhere, which is in the middle of Ireland. And there was some town, there was just a few households that didn't have the internet, that didn't have like the actual, you know, fiber optic line, the cable, as it were, coming into your house. And they just decided it was just like not cost effective. It cost the same to give them free internet. And then we had to ring these people and tell them, guess what? You're getting free internet. You don't have to pay for connection costs. It's there. Just letting you know. And I still had people going, no, please remove it. No, take it out. It's just there. If you don't want it, you don't have to use it. No, please remove it. That's what I did when I was kind of finishing this book. So. Same kind of thing. I didn't mind working for the phone company, actually. I liked not having a job that was too, that wasn't using the same kind of part. Like when I would leave that job, both full-time and when it was part-time, you know, I just left it and forgot about it as soon as I was out the door, and it hadn't exercised any of the sort of muscles, as it were, that you also use for writing. So, I know people who teach, or like they review a lot, or kind of do a lot of book reviews, and that tends to put people off writing. It kind of exhausts them. But so I was happy enough.
You
to
can that. Write a phone company novel, is what it sounds like.
Yeah.
I remember when I this book was coming out, and I told one of the kind of my manager in when I was working part time in Aircom, and he was just he was like, oh, we're all mad in here. There's so many stories in here, and he's like, I bet we'll all be in the book. There's nothing about a call center in the book at all.
A few gas stations though, and some bars for sure.
Yeah.
Actually, Colin, now that you've brought up Ireland, I'm curious about the place in all of your books. Megan. Your book travels across the country. Angela, Colin, and Tracy, you guys are, your novels are all sort of within city limits. And Azarine, your novel is pretty much like bound within one property, except for like a quick trip into a canyon. So I'm curious, where you set the sort of boundaries of the worlds that you create and how you explore those and what those limits do for the narrative. Azri?
So are you asking about this particular book or in general?
Well, this one for now, unless you prefer to address another one. But I think, and for those of you that haven't read Frau Keeler yet, and you'll speak to this better than I can, but it is focused very much within Frau Keeler's home and what's on the property and the sort of strange neighbors.
The sort of sense of place in the novel actually creates the tension and the movement that I think energizes the narrative. The plot is really, really sparse. It's sort of associative, and we're sort of inside the mind or the consciousness of this narrator for so long. And eventually, when he does leave the house, there's a kind of violent collision between his sense of unreality and the external world. And that's the only thing that can happen after he's been inside his house and in this state of isolation and thinking about, wars and what it means to sort of have a mind and this sort of repetitive, loopy sort of thinking process that he seems to be stuck in and unable to break out of. And eventually there is a kind of violence that occurs at the end of the novel, and that's sort of him entering reality again causes this rupture. So that sort of final explosion, that's sort of a very philosophical in nature, wouldn't really be possible without this sense of isolation and interiority. And I also think of novels as kind of architecture a lot, and I kind of think that they're very durational and they're dynamic and sculptural in a way, and the spaces that I design for my narrators are usually sort of extensions of their inner worlds. And I've also sort of grew up all over the world, and I'm very sensitive to space and to the way that space affects our emotions and the way that we think and the possibilities that we can sort of experience. And the book I'm working on now is sort of takes place in the Western Mediterranean, and it's really sort of also aware of the relationship between literature and landscape and mortality and architecture. So it's landscape is really fundamental to me as a writer.
So I think that in my book, part of what's going on with place is a refusal of certain places, or a refusal to see the world beyond a very particularized cartography. So in this book, the narrator, Allie, is really obsessed with only one thing in the world, essentially, and she can't do it anymore. And so she's only a teenager. She hasn't really lived a life. She hasn't really gone anywhere. But she is under the impression that the world is sort of bereft of any more exciting places or opportunities for her. So in a lot of ways, this book to me was a book that asked to not locate anywhere, right? In a way to sort of focus on this relic of a place, which only exists at this point in the form of memory. And for this character, that is the most wonderful, beautiful place in the world, which to anyone else would be probably fairly frivolous, which is an ice skating arena, right? And so that's the place where she feels like you see something that's extraordinary, where you aren't just a regular person, where people are allowed to have feelings that they can't have in their regular lives. And otherwise, after that, she's pretty much just hanging out in her bedroom, going to AA, hanging out in her bedroom, going to AA. So,
man, place is a huge part of my book. This isn't an autobiographical book, but I did leave Tulalip, Washington when I was about 17, vowing to never come back and just like kick the dirt of that town off my feet. And I bounced around and from one side of the country to the next. And I think that there's a line in the book that probably says it better than I will now, but when I really thought it through, but just this, I always had this idea that somewhere I'd arrive and it would be like everyone was waiting for me, you know, like I would step into the life that was waiting for me and everybody would be like, what took you so long to find us, you know? And I remember, you know, going, I was in Minnesota doing a writing residency and I was just terribly desolate at that point. I had been living in Texas and I didn't want to go back. And the writing residency was ending and I remember that I had thought that if I finished the book, it would immediately get sold and somehow then someone would tell me where to go next or what to do. And like the book would become, you know, that would somehow direct the next piece of my life. And it's interesting, so much about it is about these really dense, like roiling landscapes, these torn up kind of mud slick landscapes of my youth in the Pacific Northwest. And I sat up in bed in Minnesota and I remember being like, what do you want to do? And I just thought, I want to go home. And of course, it turns out that living in Seattle is a lot different than going back to your parents' acreage in Tulalip. So that, you know, that was a revelation I quickly made, that I wasn't exactly just turning around and going back home. But so I think it's, you know, it's sort of, in some ways now, and of course it sounds really hippity-dippity, but I feel like I kind of wrote my way back to that place a little bit, and I recognized as I was writing it how intensely I knew it, you know, and people would always say, like, how did you, you know, did you research these places? And I really pulled from this book the different places that I have called home and have lived in. In particular, Tulalip, which is used in its own, you know, I use it as it exists in the book. But so the characters, the mother is in an abusive relationship, and the 18-year-old son is, he's gay, and he's also makes kind of this crappy teenage move when he, his father kind of pushes him around a bit, and he lets his father know where they've been hiding from him. So the mother takes the daughter and ends up leaving on her own with the daughter. She wants her son to find his own life. She knows that he's gay and wants him to hopefully move forward in his life on his own. So he ends up in a fictionalized version of Kellogg, Idaho, called Silver. And, you know, I found with towns that I don't, landscapes I know, but towns I don't know that well, that's where I start wanting to create them, just to fudge them a little bit and blur them so you don't have that kind of responsibility to authenticity. Where am I going with this? I think that, you know, writing about these places that I knew, whether or not they were fictionalized versions of places I'd been or actual places I'd lived, I sort of just threw it all into this cornucopia of where I've lived. And now, as I'm writing my second book, it is set in Linton, Indiana, in the years surrounding World War II, before and after. And I think that part of that was, I just realized, like, I've been given this tremendous opportunity and gift with the way that this book has been received for a small press book. And I just feel like it's like, okay, like, take a chance, you know? And I think it's a really awesome and breathless place to be, to think, like, I'm going to do this thing that's really hard and that scares me, and I would rather just write another novel set in the dark little corner of the Northwest, but, like, I want to try this thing, you know? So that's going to be a whole different experience of writing place, place and time in a way that I've never done before. So wish me luck.
So I believe that one of the reasons that people are sort of concerned about what happens in certain cities, I think we've seen that very recently with some of the things that have happened over the past few weeks. There are a lot of other factors that go into the way that we're concerned about cities. One is, like, what sort of bodies do we value more than others? Mm. But part of it is how these cities live in our literary imaginations and how they live in sort of the pop culture representation. I really can't do much for pop culture, but I was concerned with the fact that, like, how does Detroit live in the literary imagination? I thought part of the reason that Detroit doesn't really live in the literary imagination is because for the past 50 years, Detroit has been 80% black. It's a city that is at its sort of at the worst part of its recession and decline, was 30% under the poverty line. But it's a city that's more than just like depression and what people call, you know, haunting landscape. It's a city with a lot of joy. So I thought, you know, I obviously cannot fill this void myself, but I can render Detroit the way that I experience it, which is a city with like good food, a lot of really loving people, and a lot of interesting stories and a lot of pride. So setting for me, particularly with this story and probably with the next one, is a way to sort of contribute something so that hopefully the next time someone is thinking about Detroit, they're on their layover in the airport, they have another sort of reference point besides like Eminem and 8 Mile. I went to Easton Bowl for like 4 days, but I was just like ready to go there, and I expected like I was just gonna like walk off the plane and it would be like I was in like an Orhan Pamuk novel. And like similarly, I haven't been to Tokyo, but I feel like Murakami has like made me ready like for Tokyo. And these things are not accurate, of course, because literature is not like an accurate portrayal of real life, but it's one of the reasons why I value those cities. When I like see something happened in Easton Bowl, even before I ever went there, I was like, you know, someone is writing about this and they're communicating to me like what these people's values are and like what normal sort of everyday experiences are. And it's certainly not, it shouldn't be the burden of literature, but I think it is one way that literature can be useful, is to just help people appreciate a place they may never go a little bit better. Mm. Oh, thank you.
place in my writing was very important. It was a book of short stories, and I knew I wanted to write a book. I was writing short stories for a few years, and some of them were crap, some of them were okay. But I kind of just, I knew I wanted to write a collection, but you kind of just, you work on one story, you try your best with that, and you kind of stumble onto the next one. And I eventually realized I kind of needed some sort of organizing principle, I guess. And I kind of just looked at the stories I'd thus far written, and the ones that just seemed to me to have a kind of particular, the ones that seemed to me to be the best, basically. And by that, I mean they had a particular kind of energy, a particular kind of vibrancy. Were one set in this sort of versions of the kind of town and area I grew up in, which seems like a very obvious thing to write about in retrospect, but I was pretty dim on that for a long time. I was trying to write books elsewhere and not in Ireland. There's we have a pretty good profile with regards to our writers contemporarily and historically, given the population and size of the country. It still stakes out a decent amount of real estate in any discussion of literature, I suppose. But what comes with that is a kind of big tradition, or kind of the shadows of people who have gone before you. And there is constant questions about what exactly is an Irish book and what does an Irish book say about Ireland. That's always there. Because Ireland's so small, mine's set in a rural town in the west of Ireland, which is a very different place even to larger urban western towns like Galway, different again to somewhere like Dublin. But Ireland's so small that every new book has to almost bear the question of what is it saying about Irish identity. I when I was younger and didn't know what I was doing, ambitious, I wanted to avoid that. I didn't want to, necessarily what I saw would, commit myself to that kind of traditional discussion. I wanted to do different things. And, eventually you wise up, you read good writers and you realize you can do that. You can write something that's kind of new and fresh and reflects the aesthetic and reflects the kind of concerns and subjects that you want to write about, but you can still do it welded to to Ireland, to a version of it that you know. And that's what I, long way round, I eventually discovered when I was looking at the stories I was writing over a number of years. The ones that spoke most to me and kind of spoke to each other were set in this sort of, the rural town, as I call it. It was a recurring type. So I kind of then, once I had two or three of the stories, I set them all in the one town. I named it Glanbey, which is the name of a street I was living on in Dublin at the time. It is a composite of a few other places that I grew up in the West. And I was a bit wary at first doing that because I thought once I commit to that, I was like, okay, well, what if I run out of stories to set in this town or they're too similar or whatever? But it actually, once I kind of consciously had it there in my head, this sort of imaginary place, but nonetheless a kind of concrete place in my imagination, it was a kind of fertile thing. It helped me. It helped generate material. It helped generate characters. It helped generate stories and the narratives. So it gave them energy. And so I realized just how important it is to have a distinct place in writing.
I think we probably have time for one more. Or should we just go to Q&A? We'll turn it over to you. First, thank you guys for your great answers. And does anyone have any questions?
Ms. Flournoy, I've driven through the east side of Detroit 8,000 times approximately, and sometimes that is my destination. Mm-hmm. And I greatly respect what you said about the joy and friendliness within Detroit. But I also wonder to what degree your willingness to immerse yourself in pain correlates with the success of your writing.
I think that for this novel, there was a way in which there was a sort of collective pain, particularly this family. The story started, it was only 2008, and then I decided after sort of like having this kind of preponderance of research and information that I didn't know what I was going to do with, because it was all about sort of the experiences of African Americans 60 years earlier when they first made Detroit home from the South. And I finally decided that I needed to include that information as well. Part of that was because I think some of the ways that people view their city, for better or worse, are tied to those first encounters when Black people from the South moved to Detroit, and the way that they were welcome, or most often was the case, not welcome. And so there's that sort of collective pain that exists from sort of trying to strive and working hard and trying to get a toehold on the American dream and then seeing what happened as a result. But then there's so that was something that I wanted to explore in a way that didn't just feel like preachy and kind of like ham-fisted. But individual characters, I think pain sort of lives up against all of the other emotions that we feel. And so it's something that one has to try to render in a way that's not just sentimental and is nuanced and kind of is surprising, because that's sort of how it works, especially if it's you're dealing with the character that I read, Layla. She has addiction, but part of that the issues there have to do with pain, something, domestic abuse that happened 20 years prior, but she's just like never dealt with it. And so obviously that's not something that's a recurring track in her mind, but it just shows up in these like surprising ways, because that's how things work when you don't deal with pain. So I don't know, I surprise myself sometimes writing those things. I'm sure everyone else would probably agree. People talk about like you need to go there, but you don't really feel like you're going there until you're there and you wrote it and you're like, ooh, that was kind of dark or whatever.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Hi, thank you all. I'm a teacher with a capital T, and I'm really excited to see my profession move from kind of dropping knowledge that can be Googled to teaching ways of thinking, of being designers, of being creators. So how did those, all of you, learn to be creative, or how do those of you who teach your students to be creative?
I
I sort of had to be creative because I first noticed it when we were living in Iran and things were very difficult and society was, you know, there's also a great deal of warmth and hospitality and joy that I experienced there, and I'm often sort of against my own better judgment very nostalgic for it, but you know, the kind of oppression that I did experience, and I'm not just talking about it as a woman, just in general in society, it's very difficult to survive there, and the arbitrariness of the legal landscape sort of forced me to be very introspective at a very young age, and we used to sort of go to the north in the summers, and I would just, you know, I just remember going on these long walks by myself along the Caspian shore, and there was a lot of abandoned houses or houses that had been kind of swallowed up by the sea and then spitted back out in pieces, and I would just kind of climb on these structures, and that space, just being in nature or being in this apocalyptic-like landscape, kind of forced me to be creative. I didn't sort of play with toys that much. I was forced to sit with myself, and I was not necessarily protected from discomfort. And I think with my students, I especially where I teach, I always try to remind them that it's being uncomfortable is part of the human experience, and the more you avoid it, the more it's going to creep up somewhere else. So you have to sort of experience that and sit with uncertainty, especially in creative writing classes, because so much of literature is connected to questions and questioning. So I try to help them sort of approach those emotional spaces and those kind of, and also ask the difficult questions. But you can't always push students before they're ready, and it's also about nurturing their tolerance.
Yeah, I think that concept of nurturing tolerance is really interesting. Two of the things I do when I teach, one of them is to do a lot of writing exercises where they don't necessarily need to complete a polished work, but they need to try something for 10 minutes. And maybe it's not something that they're interested in doing, and maybe it's not something they would do on their own, but for 10 minutes, maybe they can write a piece where you only hear one side of a conversation, right? Like somebody's picked up the phone and you're only hearing their side, not the other. Or, you know, they can try for 10 minutes doing like a sort of faux self-help like Laurie Moore would do. And I think trying on those voices, right? I mean, kids do it too. It's dress up, and there's no reason that you shouldn't be trying dress up in your own writing as well. And so it's that, and it's reading things that are radically different. I would love to see more of my students also reading more theory, actually, as well, because theory for me has been a source of a lot of inspiration, thinking about, okay, if we were to have this character and this was what their worldview was, what would that mean about the way that they lived their life? What would a Tuesday look like for somebody who believes X, Y, and Z? Or, you know, what would it be like to go on a date with somebody who thinks this? So there's that. But in terms of my own experience of learning to be creative, you know, I would say that I'm adopted, and I think that the knowledge very early on in my life that my parents had sort of, in a way, of their own sort of imaginary, with their own powers of imagination had created family, I think that sort of made me feel like imagination was something powerful and wasn't sort of something that just existed in an ether, right? If you can sort of just decide these people are, you know, these kids are going to be my family, you know, then you can make a lot of other decisions in your life just by, you know, sort of considering other possibilities. So that was really important too.
I think that, obviously, I think reading was probably my biggest ticket to creating. I was born with just this very. I've always had this sense of being sort of mad that I wasn't able to be born into multiple lives, that you only get one, you know, and you only get one sort of frame of reference. And so from there, I feel like I just really have always strove to sort of cheat that idea by creating these imaginary worlds around me. You know, just the bounds of like where you can kind of travel in your mind, or the, you know, this really satisfying feeling of creating a world whole cloth. The other piece I think that I took creativity for me now and when I'm working with students is just sort of sensing, looking at the world around you through a lens of emotional resonance, like seeing what kinds of objects we, what we attach feeling to and emotions and memory. And, you know, there's so much about, you know, the vase that was in the room when your mother died, like that, you know, that vase has taken on this, this sense of emotion. And we walk around a world that has both sort of fixed symbols and mutable ones that we can assign our own to. And for me, that it's, it has made me feel like language and emotion and memory are all connected in the world around me, and I want to transfer that onto the page, which is sort of a, it's an inarticulate idea, but I think just everything I do on the page is about wanting to create emotion through language. And when I start to look at the world around me with that same sense of like, where is the emotion here, and you know, how does this resonate, then I feel like things start to come alive a little bit more.
So there used to be this show on BET called Rhapsody, The Basement, and they used to have like this little booth in which people would freestyle. And I was obsessed with this show when I was younger, because the thing about like freestyling that is really interesting and kind of exciting to watch, especially from like really established sort of like artists, is that they're the moments where like the kind of the rhyme doesn't line up, or something is really corny, or like they just say like your shirt is orange, are actually the moments that are like the best. They're the moments that confirm that this is happening, like they haven't just memorized something, and that they are like just human like the rest of us, and sometimes they can't think of anything. And that's really what I try to foster when I teach, is just like a sort of like screw it, we're just trying stuff out environment. And also, as much as like I value craft and I can tell you why this is working and why that's not working, I also try to, in a way that's sort of pedagogically useful, explain that it's not that you can never write in second person, it's just that you didn't pull it off. And I think that is something that a lot of teachers, it's easier to just say like, stay away from second person, but that's not true. The truth is like, you just messed up when you did it, and that's fine. That means you can try again. That doesn't mean like you have to take that out of your toolbox. And so that's probably the thing that I think I try to foster, is sort of that feeling of like, it's just everybody sometimes is going to be like, you know, your shirt is orange. That doesn't mean that you're not, you know, you're not a really talented, like in the 90s, like the all of the most famous rappers went to the basement and freestyled, and some of them weren't that great, but that just meant that they were human.
I guess your question is about just, I'll take it from creativity being fostered in myself when I was growing up, or who put it there. I just think no one really discouraged me. No one told me not to do it. I was allowed just, you know, sit in the corner with a copybook and draw, or, you know, make stuff up. So I was just kind of lucky that my parents, primarily, probably just because they couldn't be arsed, just they were like, yeah, he's quiet in the corner, let him keep drawing, let him keep reading. So yeah, I grew up with a sort of benign, sort of a tacit permission to do it from them. And that doesn't sound like a big thing, but it was just they just let you create your own kind of structure and have a little, I think it's agency. That's what you kind of want to get in kids, that you can do it, you know, or anyone who's at any stage is doing something creative. I do meet people all the time who go, I could never write, I'm not creative or whatever. And, you know, you're like, well, you can. I mean, you just probably haven't, you know, spent as much time trying to do it as I have, for instance, or any of us. And not because we're necessarily brilliantly talented, but we've just, for whatever reason, we've decided to stick at it. And we've done dozens and dozens of drafts to get to write a piece of prose that might end up looking relatively eloquent or effortless. And you're like, that's the end result of a very long process. And I think, because creativity is kind of, you know, what you're saying, it's almost, not that it's the opposite or set against it, but a lot of what you get in school, I'm talking at like what we'd call, you know, pre-adolescent and teenage level is, you know, it's structure and it's prescribed, it's prescriptive. And it is trying to get people into a headspace where they can abandon that and, you know, do what they want. So I kind of got that just completely by accident or by an intuition of my parents, for instance. And so I was lucky in that regard. I think that
is this working? There we go. I think that's a good place for us to stop. I know I want more, and hopefully you do too, from our wonderful honorees. So come back in just under 2 hours to the same room and hear them read more. You'll find out more about their characters. But for now, please join me in thanking our 535 honorees and Benjamin Samuel for this terrific, terrific panel.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.